Welcome everyone to We Shall Overcome, Music and Equitable Healing. Thank you for joining us for an hour of music and conversation with Project STEP, Longwood Symphony Orchestra, and friends working on the front line for social justice and healing. Tonight's program is particularly timely and relevant given the state of affairs in this country and around the world, namely a pandemic and a renewed spotlight on racism and equity. I'm Alex McCray, a Project STEP board member since 2017. My primary professional role is Senior Director of Programs at Philanthropy Massachusetts, a membership organization that serves both funders and nonprofits around the Commonwealth with opportunities to learn, network, share resources, build skills, and connect and build community. Just a few Zoom housekeeping tips. Please note that with all technology, things sometimes happen. Should any difficulties arise, please be patient with our team as we navigate our way to getting back on track. Also, please feel free to use the chat feature for community conversation or inquiries. The digital program booklet link is also available in the chat. A little bit about Project STEP for those of you who may be less familiar with the organization. Since 1982, Project STEP has provided talented young musicians of color with comprehensive music instruction, including private lessons, orchestra, master classes, mentorship, and summer music camps. Black musicians account for 1.2% of our nation's orchestras, and Latinx musicians make up about close to 2%. Project STEP has been advocating for equity and inclusion in the arts and classical music field for nearly 40 years. With 57 students in the program, we not only want to make sure we can support our students today, but well into their future. So each student is a significant investment. 100% of Project STEP graduates have gone on to college or conservatory, and approximately 60% into a music profession. We're only able to do this because of community support. As with thousands of nonprofits across the state, Project STEP during the pandemic pivoted to shifting to online platforms through virtual lessons, private lessons, music theory classes, and streaming recitals and workshops. We are keeping our talented young musicians active, engaged, and learning. We believe in a future where the classical music profession reflects the racial and ethnic composition of our communities. Our program has always been a platform to fight injustice. And in these last months, it has been a haven for expression during the pandemic. We continue to amplify the stories and voices of our young musicians, providing space within our community for them to be heard. Please help me welcome from the Longwood Symphony Orchestra, Dr. Michael Barnett.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Alex, for the introduction. I'd like to introduce myself now. I'm Dr. Michael Barnett. I'm the board chair of the Longwood Symphony Orchestra and a primary care physician at Brigham and Women's Hospital. I also wear another hat as a professor at the Harvard School of Public Health and am honored to be able to play oboe with the orchestra as well. I wanted to give folks who may be less familiar with the Longwood Symphony a better sense of what our organization does and how well we overlap with Project STEP. The Longwood Symphony is the orchestra of Boston's medical and healthcare community. The mission of our orchestra is and has always been to heal the community through music. And of course, as Alex mentioned, this is more important now than ever before, as we are all isolated and trying to find our way back to reentry in the COVID pandemic. And I think the power of music and community is going to be more vital than any time in recent memory. Many of the musicians of the Longwood Orchestra were also on the front lines of care in the emergency room, in the lab, or as nurses and physical therapists. We've found ways to keep making music and bring it to the community, and combine both the medical expertise of our musicians with our mission to heal the community through music. We played at hospitals, at vaccine sites, and have tried to do everything we can to bring music virtually or live to community in a safe way. One very important shift this year was taking our community partnerships virtually. It's been very important for us to continue these partnerships and highlight the amazing work that our partner nonprofits do for underserved communities. We are especially proud to partner with Project STEP for tonight's event that will touch on health equity and how music has been a force for healing and building resilience. Even in my own experience as a primary care doctor, I'm reminded basically every day of how disproportionately COVID and the pandemic, both the economic effects as well as the direct effect of the disease, has affected communities of color. I think more now than ever, it's very important to support communities of color and promote diversity across all sectors. So with that, I'd like to kick things off with a performance from our virtual brass ensemble of the Longwood Symphony of La Peri Fanfare by Paul Dukas. Everyone give a virtual round of applause to our virtual brass ensemble. Next in the program, I'd like to introduce a fireside chat with two illustrious orthopedic surgeons, Dr. Augustus White and Dr. Mark Gebhardt, who are going to discuss the history of health inequity and how it relates to COVID-19 and the overall pandemic. Let me introduce both of these individuals who have, have had amazing careers and impact on our community. So Dr. Augustus White. Dr. White was the orthopedic surgeon in chief at the Beth Israel Hospital in Boston for 13 years. Today, he's the Ellen and Melvin Gordon Distinguished Professor of Medical Education and Professor of Orthopedic Surgery at Harvard Medical School. He's also a former professor of the Harvard MIT Division of Health Sciences and Technology and a former advisory dean of the William Augustus Hinton Society at HMS, Harvard Medical School. He currently serves as the director of the Culturally Competent Care Education Program at HMS. Throughout his career, Dr. White has committed himself to issues of diversity and is nationally recognized for his work in medical education and issues of healthcare disparities. Next, what I'd like to do is introduce Dr. Mark Gebhardt, my colleague in the WIN section. Dr. Gebhardt is an orthopedic oncologist with an expertise in pediatric bone and soft tissue sarcomas and other musculoskeletal tumors. He treats adults and children with sarcomas at both Boston Children's Hospital and the Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center. He has served on the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons Board of Directors and is a chair of the Board of Specialty Societies and director of the American Board of Orthopedic Surgery, among many other distinguished honors. He has been a great supporter for women in orthopedics and has named four female division chiefs, winning the Diversity Award from the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons in 2018. Dr. Gebhardt is also Longwood Symphony Principal Clarinet and has served as the LSO Chair of the Board of Directors twice. Here are Dr. White and Dr. Gebhardt in conversation, and enjoy.
So Gus, you and I have had many conversations over the years, usually at dinner with a nice glass of wine, about racial disparities and healthcare. But can you provide us with a brief history of health, of how healthcare differed for people of color? They had poorer care, less humane care.
Unfortunately, this history is very long and very dramatic and very powerful. And really, and occasionally unbelievably inhumane. And I don't exaggerate at all. It's just so well documented for many, many years, going back well into European medical history. And sadly, so much of it has been incentivized and perpetrated and practiced by the medical profession. And it's just amazing how skin color and hair texture on our fellow human beings has stimulated such a history. And it's not debatable. It's not whether you believe it or not. It's not like religion. It's all documented. There are 13 groups of individuals, groups of people in our society who experience at least 13 extensive healthcare disparities. And it isn't just African Americans. It includes Asian Americans. It includes women and includes elderly people, gays, lesbians, transgender people, Latinos, disabled people, obese people. And it's an unfortunate reality. There's a lot of humanitarianism in our medical world, for sure, but there's also a terrible amount of inhumanity. So that's kind of the history. And the history is intricately combined and thoroughly fueled and perpetrated by numerous other social realities, politics and economics and education. All of these things synergize with the terrible inhumanity of racism.
For the past year, we've all been living through the COVID-19 pandemic. And in the US, over 500,000 people have died. Can you comment on how this has affected people of color?
Yeah, well, it's certainly dramatically more prevalent among people of color. And the numbers and the ongoing statistics of complications, of prevalence of disease, of deaths, of lack of adequate treatment of their disabilities and pain management occurs on a day-to-day basis. And a number of individuals who and institutions and organizations that are working to address these things, it comes along with the inherent racism in our society. And it's called the social determinants of health. You know, it's related to education and economics and employment and living conditions and availability of health care, availability of good food.
Yeah, you and I were looking at an article from the New England Journal that recently, I think April 1st, that said the death rate is 9 times higher in African Americans and American Native Americans, and Latinx and Hispanics have 3 times as many deaths as their white counterparts. So it clearly has had an effect on the COVID pandemic. But at the same time, minority populations are distrustful of the vaccines we now have for COVID-19, and in part because of the history and in part because of the rapid development and testing and uncertainty if the testing included representative populations. And is that true? And what can we do to combat the fear of these potential life-saving vaccines?
Well, it's a combination of educating individuals who resist the idea of having a vaccination and try to educate them in a context that you can hope for some, ability to have them accept your message of education, whether it's a famous entertainer or a doctor or a famous athlete or a minister or someone that they quote unquote can trust. And if you combine that education with a delivery package of someone that they can trust, an environment that they can have faith in, or an institution that they can trust, perhaps they are more likely to accept and be convinced to do what overwhelming scientific and logical evidence suggests is in their best interest. There are Caucasian individuals who have not necessarily experienced or have any of these documented biases against their good health, who assiduously resist the vaccination as well. But that's another whole challenge which I think we are all trying to address as well, because it's in the overall best interest of the society as a whole.
Do you want to comment just for a second or a minute on where the distrust comes from, you know, like Tuskegee? And
well, Tuskegee is a prototypical classic example, and maybe one of the probably most well-known. And a study was carried out at Tuskegee Institute in which the doctors, in order to know and understand and have some idea of the natural course of the disease, followed a number of African-American males with a diagnosis of syphilis and purported to be treating them, but were not in fact treating them, but were giving them a placebo medication, which means that they obviously were not being treated, and then following them very carefully to see how the disease would develop and manifest itself untreated. And this was subsequently admitted, recognized, addressed, apologized for, I think, by President Clinton. And of course, it's a dramatic way of documenting and pointing out and communicating the resistance to a lot of African Americans to the idea of a vaccination.
All right. In the final couple of minutes, can you tell us about the Augustus A. White Institute and what its goals are, and then touch on ways we can deal with these situations with resiliency techniques? I think they'll be talking later about how music can help us, but what are your thoughts about the White Institute and resiliency?
My friend and colleague, Macy Russell, is a distinguished attorney here in Boston, a member of Beth Israel Hospital Board and many other boards. And he actually read a book, our book, Seeing Patients, Unconscious Bias in Healthcare, some years ago. And that tweaked his humanitarian interests to the point that he wanted to really do what he could about it. And he, about the issues of healthcare disparities and inhumane care that people were experiencing. So he had this idea of trying to develop an institute that could address these issues. And so the Evolving Institute seeks to address issues of equitable, humane health care in our society for all people. And in particular, we are addressing some of the conspicuous groups that I have just mentioned earlier, people of color, people with less environmental resources and who are suffering the social determinants of health. So the theme is good health care, equitable health care for all of our fellow humans, and a culture and a attempt to perpetrate humanitarianism to provide good health care. And then the other part of it, Mark, you mentioned
resiliency. Yeah. How do we get through this until all these problems are solved?
Yeah, I'm so glad you addressed that. And I hope people will take this on faith because I can't prove it. But there's a lot of indirect evidence that suggests that in our common humanity, our DNA, by the way, of which is 99.9% identical across all people of all races, of all colors, of all ethnicities. We are 99.9% identical in our DNA. But our human brain and our various psychological capacities and potentials really provide a tremendous resource for us to develop resiliency. And it's all there. It's all part of it if we can look at it, recognize it, address it, and practice it. We believe that it's like building up muscles. You know, if you exercise right, you can build up your muscles. And resilience provides us with happiness, with resources, with ability, better ability to overcome adversity. And this is something that we have to address. Believe me, I don't have scientific proof of it, but there are numerous examples. If you look around you in the world, you see people who overcome phenomenal adversity. And that's due to their resilience. And also not just overcoming, but having happiness, having a better quality of life if they can practice some of these activities. So we encourage you, while we're waiting to solve all of these horrendous problems in the world and working on them, the environment, the climate, the various isms, the racisms, and the many, many other realistic problems that we have, they ain't going to go away tomorrow. You know, we got to work on them. We can work on them. Sooner or later, we must make progress. We will make progress. And I think when all of us, everyone, puts in their efforts within their sphere of influence and tries to do the right thing, tries to make an allyship, if you will, with humanitarian justice and concentrate on that and push back at every chance. We all have a sphere around us which we can impact and we can influence. And if we work assiduously on that, we can push back and improve and begin to eliminate and diminish these isms. And if we have resilience, as I said, we can be happier and we can be also more effective in pushing back.
So maybe just for a second, since the rest of this program is going to be how music helps us get through these times, just personally for you, I know you love jazz. So how has music impacted your ability to cope and have resilience?
Well, I love jazz. I love many, many, many kinds of music. And I wanted very much to be a musician, but I was not successful in that. And my excuse is that my piano teacher was really mean. She was a mean lady. And she scared me to death. I hated to go to piano lessons. But I love the music. I really enjoyed the music. And I think music is good for the soul. We all know that. You know that so very well yourself. And it provides relaxation, comfort, emotional gratification, inspiration, joy. You know, we can dance to it. And it's just a wonderful human resource. And one of the reasons that I'm sure that it's so international and multicultural is the fact that it's such an innate part of our human nature, and just a wonderful, obviously, contribution that the Long One Symphony provides to this New England environment and to our medical environment. And I've had the pleasure, enhanced through my friendship with you, to be closer to that than I might otherwise be. So it's just an absolute joy and a wonderful note to, I think, end on, if you will.
It's a perfect segue into the rest of the program.
Okay.
I want to thank you so much. It's been a pleasure having this little fireside chat, and we look forward to listening to the rest of the program. Thank you, Gus.
And there's a fireside.
There's a fireside.
Right there. Beautiful.
That's right. Can't have a fireside chat without a fireside.
All right. Thank you.
I just want to thank both Drs. White and Gebhardt for that pretty powerful fireside chat. I just want to share that there were a number of items in there that struck me, and I presume that a number of pieces within that fireside chat resonated with you as well. One, the power of music in terms of supporting our soul and helping us to build resiliency. Another, how the healthcare system for a very long time has been different for folks of color. And the words that Dr. White used were, it's a long history, it's a dramatic history, it's a powerful one, and in some cases, an unbelievably inhumane one, documented for hundreds, for a very long time. That's pretty powerful. Three, the synergy between racism and areas like politics and economics and education. And then fourth is just, we all have a role to play in working within our own sphere of influence to eliminate these isms. So next, we will feature a performance from a Project STEP string quartet coached by Mariana Greenhill, who is also performing here on viola. During the pandemic, our teachers and students have been resilient and found creative ways to continue learning and connecting through chamber music online. In this performance, this Project STEP quartet is performing the original theme from the 2019 film Knives Out, composed by Nathan Johnson. But first, we will hear from Ridley, one of the violinists in the group, about some of the themes and concepts they discussed while learning this piece.
The movie Knives Out, directed by Ryan Johnson and released November 27th, 2019, is a murder mystery that begins as a whodunit but progresses to add pressing societal themes relevant in the current day as the drama and tension increases. This movie deals with illegal immigration, socioeconomic class, and the manipulation that comes from power differences, alongside the mystery of a character's death. All of these themes and struggles are portrayed at the very start of the movie, before any information is relayed, using a short composition, but one filled with sharp notes and set at a running pace. Before the plot even comes into play, the opening song conveys a sense of desperation and the need to flee with the way all the individual voices of the quartet interact. They bleed into each other, with only enough variety to know that they are separate, making up a single narrative from a multitude of different stories. They are not at war with one another, rather they all have a mutual goal that is driven by anguish, which leans heavily into the immigration theme in the story. In the larger scheme of the piece, the sense of mystery and tension is felt throughout because of the minor key and particularly memorable phrase that closes the piece, which leaves the listener with a pounding heart. Just as in the movie, this piece is not a lighthearted one, but rather that of intrigue, suspense, and the journey of many told through one.
Bravo, that was absolutely amazing. Thank you. Now we'd like to invite musicians from both organizations, LSO as well as Project STEP, who are featured in our final piece. But first, we want to learn from their many years of experience with Longwood Symphony Orchestra and Project STEP. From Longwood Symphony Orchestra, we have Dr. Lisa Wong, a physician, musician, arts advocate, and author, dedicated to the healing arts of music and medicine. She has been a pediatrician at Milton Pediatric Associates for nearly 30 years and is an assistant professor of pediatrics at Harvard Medical School. As a violinist and past president of LSO, Dr. Wong established the Healing Art of Music program that helps raise awareness and funds for medical nonprofits in the community. Dalilah Mostoslavsky, violin, is a senior at the Boston Latin School. Dalilah auditioned into STEP in 2017 and currently studies with Lucia May. Dalilah previously toured Italy with New England Conservatory's Youth Symphony Orchestra and serves as a student mentor for younger students at STEP. Dalilah plans to study mechanical engineering and comparative literature after graduation. Nathan Theodore, viola, is a junior at Watertown High School. He currently studies with Michael Zaretsky of the Boston Symphony Orchestra and was a semifinalist in the 2017 SEC Concerto Competition. He's a member of the Boston Philharmonic Youth Orchestra and has performed throughout Europe and Brazil. Nathan joined Project STEP through the Kindergarten Focus Program in 2010. Finally, Xavier Ip, cello, is a sophomore at Buckingham Brown and Nichols School in Cambridge. He auditioned into Project STEP in 2018 and currently studies cello with Mark Churchill. He's also a student of Bridge to Equity and Achievement in Music, known as BEAM, a collaborative between Boston's top music training programs for youth. Xavier recently performed in an international masterclass for cellist Johann Moser. Please help me welcome these musicians.
Hello, everybody. And thank you, Alex, for that wonderful introduction. And thank you for the beautiful Knives Out music to the other this Project STEP quartet. I am very excited to be here. I have been a big fan and supporter of Project STEP and for all you do for a long time. And it's such an honor to meet all of you. We have an entire string quartet right here between all of us, right? Dalilah, you play the violin, and Nathan, you're a violist, and Xavier, you're a cellist. And I can go either way. I can do viola or violin, so we can play it. We can be a quartet. But it's been a tough year now, hasn't it? I assume that you've all been mainly virtual and sometimes together in school, or maybe you're coming back to class now. So how has music helped you get through this quarantine period? Let's go in the order of high strings to low strings. So Dalilah, what's it been like?
Well, for me, I've definitely used music as a way to feel connected to those who I've been distanced from lately. Before, I was part of a few orchestras, both through my school and through the New England Conservatory. As you can imagine, the format for these had to change pretty drastically. Thankfully, I was still able to get a sense of connection and camaraderie by playing with the Project STEP Honors Quintet and through some chamber groups at the River School Conservatory. When lockdown first began and there was no real framework that was supportive of musical virtual learning, it was easy to feel cut off from the world. But later on, knowing that I could still play with my peers, it made me feel like I was in the rehearsal room playing with them and not like I was in reality all alone in my room playing violin by myself.
Well, I think it's the wonderful sense of connection, knowing that you're sharing music together, that is a helpful thing to get us through. I'm glad you were able to find that. And what about you, Nathan?
For me, it was more like structure. Even though I had to change a little bit of that structure in the beginning, as I'm sure you guys can imagine, like even though all this stuff is happening out there in the world, I still need to practice and I still need to be able to play the pieces that I'm like that my teacher assigns me. And so, music was like that structure for me.
Were you able to practice every day?
Since I'm a junior and I'm doing like more stuff than I was doing sophomore year, I did cut down on my hours a bit, but, I do practice, like I try to practice, like, I want to say 3 or 4 days out of the week. But like when I do practice, it's very like focused, very intense. I make sure that I'm like combing everything because I don't have the luxury to like not be completely in the moment there.
Yeah, well, sometimes concentrated practice rather than distracted practice is more effective. Did you find it was kind of your island to come home to, your familiar space during these times?
Definitely when it's like, when I have a piece that I've been working on for a long time, like it makes more sense. And like my mind is like able to comprehend it easier. And so it's definitely like a place where even though I'm like focused, I can still relax because it's all there. And I'm just making sure that I've still got it or I'm like improving on certain parts or like increasing musicality. And it's all this like technical stuff, but it's still like very comfortable space.
That's great. And Xavier, well, how did your cello help you get through this period?
So basically music has helped me through quarantine because I've basically had a lot more downtime and a lot more time than I usually do anyway. So I'm able to spend a lot of time playing music as well as listening to it. And I can listen to a lot of different types of music, and music is such a beautiful thing that it gives you like kind of a lot of different emotions depending on what you listen to. And playing is not really the same as it was when we're rehearsing in person as a group, chamber, and orchestra. But I've had a lot more time to excel on my solo pieces and just practicing in general.
That's great. I like hearing how you've all of you sort of were moving forward with your music, but you're also stepping back and with this quarantine, you know, taking some time to sort of reflect on pieces that you've learned before. Because I think every time we go back to a piece, the same thing is when we play an orchestral piece that we've played before, you learn something new, but you are building, you're scaffolding, we call it, you know, you're building on something that you've had before, and that gives you a sense of security. But it improves you because you're building on the techniques that you've already had.
So Dr. Wong, how has music helped you during this quarantine period?
Yeah, you know, it's the same thing. Initially, when it started, I felt like, well, I should focus on my medicine and not on my music because it didn't feel like my music was relevant. And then very quickly, I came back to, oh, of course, music is more relevant than ever. There's more of a need for people to hear music and to play music together. And just like you, you know, we're not able to, the Longwood Symphony hasn't rehearsed and played together for almost a year now, and we miss that. But we remember those times, and we also find that just the friendships that we've built and the ones that we can lean on keep us moving forward. So one of the things that we did was we started something called Boston Hope Music. And we're recording music for patients and sending the recorded music to them. And then we are also arranging for music lessons for the doctors in the hospitals to start learning lessons and so that they had music with them too. And now we've been playing in the vaccine centers, as they mentioned earlier. To play in the vaccine centers has been a real treat because you play with somebody else. So we're, I've played with Javier, and it's been wonderful to be able to play chamber music and give it away, give music to somebody else, which is, I think, what music is all about. So one of the things that I love about STEP is it's not just about learning music lessons, but you learn the stories of the composers, you learn the depth of the music, like the whole introduction before Knives Out. I didn't know any of that, and it makes the music mean so much more. But also, I think all of you have been involved in your community and giving your music to members of the community and performing for them. So I was wondering if you can share more about what community performances you've done with STEP and community service or in nursing homes and, you know, all the different places. And so let's change it up. And Nathan, why don't we start with you? But I have a question. So you started in STEP when you're a youngster?
Yeah, I started like around 6 or 5, I think, like fresh out of kindergarten.
Wow. So you're really a... You're sort of one of the, you're the old man in the group, even though you're though you're young. So tell me about that, and just tell me about how you've been able to share your music.
Just from the amount of time that I've been in Project STEP, I've had countless opportunities for performance. It's actually kind of hard to like think of some specific examples, but I do remember playing in like old homes a lot, especially with my chamber music groups. Like I remember the Honors Quartet a couple years ago, and I mean I'm sure the Honors Quintet would have as well if we had if we were able to play during this quarantine. But we used to play in a lot of old homes because like they really love to hear the music and how much we know about it and how well we can play it. I've also had performance opportunities to play on like some pretty like big places, like the NAC competition that was largely due to like Project STEP and how they got me like a private teacher and all that stuff. And also the Project STEP, I think it was like a 35-year anniversary of it, I got to play on the Jordan Hall stage with another person. It was like a duo. And I think that was really cool to have that opportunity and that experience.
That's wonderful. I love that you're playing in the nursing homes for people who are isolated and wouldn't otherwise have a chance to hear live music. And I think it means so much more also that you're a young person playing music. So they're seeing, you know, the next generation. Xavier, are you doing some work outside in the community as well with your music?
Yeah, so probably the most memorable community performance was when I performed at the Brookhaven Nursing Home in Lexington. I performed like for a lot of different communities, but the people at Brookhaven are always like really engaged in our performances, and they're really nice and welcoming, and they're always happy to hear us. So.
What kind of music did you play for them?
I can't really remember the piece we played right now because it was a few years back. But it was with our quartet, so it was nice.
That's wonderful. And I think Brookhaven, I agree with you, it's a particularly lovely place. And I think they are now starting to open up again because of because the residents are vaccinated. And so hopefully the STEP groups will be able to play there again soon. And Dalilah?
Well, we've done quite a few community performances with the Project STEP chamber groups. Over the years, we've played at the Museum of Fine Arts and the Isabella Stewart Garden for MLK Day. And we've even been honored to play for the Mayor's State of the City Address at Symphony Hall in 2020. That was really fun. But while all of these performances were so meaningful, I'd say that one of the most important performances, for me at least, was when we played at the Church on the Hill for some of our older donors. It was really nice because after the performance, we were able to go and talk with some of the audience. And it was really nice because we got to hear some of their stories, we got to hear their backgrounds. I remember striking up a conversation with this really, really kind older woman. And the second she heard that I go to the Boston Latin School, she yelled for her friend to come over. Just like, I forget her friend's name, but she was like, come over, because she was also from Boston Latin School. And it was just incredible to think that this woman, this alum, she was one of the first women of color to be accepted into the school. It's just insane to think that she was able to go to this institution in such a different time.
Wow. Yeah. Well, you know, thank you for all of this. It's really so inspiring. And just remembering as you move forward, you know, all of these different experiences, because I think they build build a whole library of experiences that you'll be able to look back on. When I was in high school, like you, I also played in a hospital, particularly of children who were born with foot deformities and they needed surgery. I'm from Hawaii. And so they were flown in from Samoa and other distant islands in the Pacific specifically to have their limb deformities fixed. But they had to stay in the hospital until they're completely healed because the doctors were worried that if they got sand into their wounds or salt water beforehand, there was no one to help them. So they stayed in the hospital for 3 or 4 weeks sometimes. And so what we did was we went there and played music for them. And this is way back in, you know, I'm old, so this is before videos and before cell phones and things like that. So we were the entertainment. We brought ukuleles and recorders and played music with the kids. And I saw how the light would go on in the kids' eyes, that they could, you know, they could hear this music, they could sing, there was some joy. And time went by in the afternoon instead of just thinking about how sore their foot was as they're healing. And so after that experience, and I would go with my quartet sometimes too, like you, but after that experience, that's when I went to college, I said, that's what I want to do. I want to be a pediatrician, you know, doing stuff to help kids get better, but I'll never give up my music and always will incorporate my music as well. So when you are, after you've played, I mean, Dalilah, you already said one of the things is that's something that's benefited you. You know, you've touched the life of that Boston Latin alum who will now speak glowingly all the time of, remember that time when that violinist came and she was from my school. But what kinds of things has this, you know, how does this help all of you, the three of you? Oh, Nathan, go ahead, but you're muted.
How has music helped me? Like during this time or in general?
Just in general. What do you learn when with these performances? I mean, we work so hard to get our performances ready to perform. But then when you add that secret sauce of playing for an audience, you know, what does that do? What, you know, when you're done, what have you come away with?
Well, if I feel like it was a good performance, I normally come away with like a feeling of just like, I guess, excitement, especially when I can see like the impact that the music has had in the audience. It's like, oh, wow, I did something, you know, and like often they'll come up to you and they'll talk about it and they're like, oh, I just love this one part. Like that's probably one of my favorite moments when somebody has like a particular part in the piece that they liked, because it just shows that like they were listening and it actually like affected them. And if it's like a performance I wasn't feeling too hot about, I'll probably come away with like some notes on my like performance, like where I should do better and how much more I should practice. But like besides that, it I mean, it also helps just in other areas of life, like just the amount of time that you realize you have to spend on something to really master that, like especially with techniques. It takes more than just like a once over, or like you can't just like whenever you practice, like most of the time, especially when I was little, I would love to just play through the piece because like that was the best part because you could hear all of it. But it really takes a lot of intentional and like focused practice on like certain sections. And then once you've built up that foundation, then you can combine it and make it into one whole thing that sounds really awesome. And I think that can apply to many things beyond music.
Yeah, I'm hearing that in what you're saying. Do you find, Dalilah and Xavier, do you find when you're that same kind of focus and attention to detail, does that apply to when you're doing calculus or when you're in your biology class too?
Oh, definitely. The having to go through performances and all the stress of being on the spotlight, it causes you to be able to hone your focus to the point that you're able to catch details that you might have missed and be able to be in the moment rather than tuning out because of the stress.
Yeah. Xavier, do you have something that you're thinking about?
I'm gonna add on to Nathan about like the impact of like when you are done performing for a group of people, like when you see like the smile on people's faces, sometimes we even got like people to like stand up, like a standing ovation. It's just like, it just feels really good to have that kind of impact on people, and it just makes you feel like you're doing something good for other people. That's kind of like a really big goal of what we're trying to do as musicians. So
that's absolutely right. I think Yo-Yo Ma talks about transcending technique. He says, you know, technique is the thing that we work on when we're in our practice rooms, but the goal of technique is to be able to play the piece so that you can transcend that when you're performing. You're just expressing human emotion and you're being a human being talking to another human being through your music. And that's when the most moving performances happen. But of course, then we go back, right? And we think about, okay, next time I'm going to do this better. Next time I won't miss that F sharp. Next time I'll, you know, I won't rush. And so we're always iterating. We're always improving. But we're all also, you know, when you're in the performance, it's really giving yourself away and giving something to someone else. That's the healing aspect. You know, that's the thing that's a balance between music and medicine, in my mind, is it's the same thing. We learn all of our medical school techniques, not because of that's all we have. It's because that's the basis. And from then on, we can touch patients and we can heal and we can listen to their stories. And that's where a lot of the healing happens. Nathan, do you have a question?
There you go. Oh, yes. I was wondering, how has your music training impacted like your medical career?
Yeah, my music and my medicine have been interwoven from the start. I think, actually, I shouldn't say it from the start, because I went to medical school and I thought, okay, I can't play any more music because I have to study 6 hours a day and I have to learn biochemistry. And so I tried to do that for a semester and my grades just fell. And then I found a piano upstairs in the rehab hospital and started practicing there. And then I found some friends who played recorder and I played the violin. And so we did Brandenburg 4. And we started playing music again and my grades went back up because I hadn't really appreciated how much music is my oxygen, and both of those things balance out. And so ever since then, it's always been a balance between the music and the medicine. And with the Longwood Symphony, the part that we're talking about, the community service part, the engaging our community partners in the work that we're doing, that's what keeps us going. You know, the orchestral concert, that's the technique, but we need to be partnered with an audience that understands and also needs to have that music in their lives as well. And so I think this is such a wonderful partnership between Project STEP and Longwood, because we're all sort of on the same page, aren't we? I think, Dalilah, you're going into biomedical engineering or something, or
mechanical
engineering. So, you know, we're all musicians and we also have many other layers to ourselves. And some of them, it'll go into focus and out of focus at different times. But, you know, I think holding on to our music is what brings us all together. But speaking of music, I think I just want to thank you all. I'm going to transition over, but you three are so inspiring. And if we have more young leaders like you, I think our world is in a good place. We've got a lot of work to do, all of us, to make life more equitable and to make healthcare more equitable, make music making more equitable. But thanks to people like you and Project STEP, I think we're on the way. So I'd like to introduce the next piece. This is our collaboration, isn't it? You know, we played together without actually playing together. The final piece on this program is We Shall Overcome. It's arranged by Adolphus Hailstork, and it comes from his series of three spirituals. So the three of you are in it. I'm in it. And also violinist Stacy Lin and cellist David Shin, both members of the Longwood Symphony, are joining us. So our sextet will now perform We Shall Overcome. Thank you.
That was pretty amazing and beautiful. I found myself just sitting here and simply listening because it was just so inspiring. So we just want to thank everyone from both the LSO as well as Project STEP for collaborating, coming together, designing, and carrying out tonight's program. We also want to thank our guests. We thank you for tuning in to this program. There were so many elements to it. The Q&A, the fireside chat with the two doctors, the music, the performances. So thank you for tuning in. All donations will be equally split from tonight's event and any contributions between both organizations, Longwood Symphony, as well as Project STEP. And we just shared the link to the YouTube. You can just go to that link and click donate. You just have to scroll down a little bit to do that. So again, we thank you for joining us. Hopefully you were inspired. And until next time, please enjoy the rest of your day.